Well, hello, it's Bruce Williams again, and today I want to present the 10th lecture in my series on the selected gross pathology of the respiratory system. We're going to talk about some arthropods, which cause mischief in the respiratory system. As I do at the beginning of all of my lectures, I want to thank my friends and colleagues who provided me these great images over the years, which allow me to put these lectures together. Here's a parasite some of you might not be familiar with. It looks like a long, flat worm, and it's attached in the cranial part of the nasopharynx of this dog. And it actually is called a tongue worm, but it's not a worm at all. It is a degenerate arthropod, which is most closely related to certain types of crustaceans like fish life, and it's known as a penniston. And we're going to look at some other penniston in this lecture which affect lower parts of the respiratory tract, but this is one whose definitive host is usually a dog or a cat and can utilize just about any intermediate host. So the large penniston attaches in the nasopharynx. It could be a little more anterior in the nasal cavity itself, and subsists on blood and tissue fluids. And it will lay actually hundreds of thousands of eggs, which are passed either swallowed and passed out in the feces, or can be passed forward in nasal secretions. And if these eggs are ingested by an intermediate host, which is usually a ruminant, cow, sheep, goat, or camel, but can also be humans as well, then when it's digested, a four-legged nymph, sort of a mite-looking animal, will burrow through the wall, go on a walkabout in the tissues, usually ending up in the liver, the lungs, or the lymph node. And that's how the disease is passed on. A dog or a cat or an unwitting person may eat the uncooked offal, O-F-F-A-L, not A-W-F-U-L. And it's sort of awful too. But if you eat the uncooked liver or lymph nodes, then you will pick up these eggs and then you will continue the life cycle. The disease is well known in certain parts of the world, including the Middle East, where it's called Halloon, and in Africa, which is where it's called the Marara syndrome, especially in northern parts of Africa, where eating uncooked liver is a delicacy, so probably not a great idea because you don't want one of these living in your nasopharynx. A well-known parasite of the nasal passages of sheep and goats is Estrus ovis, and you can see a cluster of these fly larvae. The adult fly will lay an egg in the mucus droplets around the nose of the sheep, and the larva, it will hatch, and the larva will actually crawl up in the nasal cavities where they generally attach somewhere back here, not too far away from the brain. The fly that does this is fairly well known to sheep. It's sort of a big fly. It has a very annoying buzzing sound, much like gadflies with cattle. So when the sheep, they see this, or they hear this fly coming, they often, if they have experience with it, will put their nose on the ground, or if there's a group of sheep, they will form a circle, all with their heads pointed to the inside and the noses on the ground. The larva will attach to the nasal mucosa, and then they will grow until it's time for them to pupate, at which time they will be snorted back out on the ground. They're very irritating, especially in large numbers, to sheep. Sheep will, when they're moving or they're attaching, they will snort and they will bang their heads on the ground to try and get these out. They don't cause a lot of problems, but they can cause because they do cause ulcerative areas in the nasal mucosa, and we know that the nasal mucosa of ruminants have a lot of organisms like fusobacterium or whatever. You can get nasal infections, you can get systemic sepsis in rare cases, and in very rare cases they can actually burrow through the cribriform plate and get up into the potential space around the brain. So most of the time, don't cause any problems, except I would imagine this has to be really distressing for the animal. But then they end up as pupa on the ground. And there are a lot of species like this. Cephenomaya in deer is one. Here's a great picture of one from a camel. And the species name of this is Cephalpina titularo. So, but a lot of ruminants have these type of agents which cause problems. Okay, here's a parasite that I just love, maybe because I love that it primarily is the parasite, one of the leading causes of disease in Lady Gouldian finches, these beautiful little birds. And we're looking at the trachea, and I wish I had a better picture, but this is all I have. And these little black specks are actually mites. This is the tracheal mite of Gouldian finches, and its name is Sternostomum trachecolum. It's an interesting parasite for a number of reasons. One is that this particular mite will infect not just the trachea, but it will affect the air sacs. You can see them in the lungs. In birds with severe infections, you can see them in the pneumatic bones. So they do move around. It's interesting because part of the reproduction is that Arnoticus reproduction occurs in the absence of male mites. They seem to know if there are no male mites around, so the gravid females will lay unfertilized eggs, and those unfertilized eggs will all turn into male mites. It's like a restocking process. And then the gravid females tend to be found in the lower tract, in the lungs, in the lower airways. The non-gravid females will move up into the sinuses and will eventually emerge and be in present around the feathers and the cere of these birds, where it could be transmitted by direct contact to other birds. So the tracheal mite of the Lady Gouldian finch, and it's probably number one cause of disease, Sternostomum trachecolum. I guarantee you, if you whip that little factoid out at your next dinner party, no one's going to know that. While we're in the avian species, let's look at some other mites that will be seen in the respiratory tract. This is Cytodites nudus, the air sac mite. And it's a parasite that you can see in a wide range of avian species, including poultry and passerine birds like canaries and pigeons. You can even see them in citicines. And it normally is found in the air sacs. That's why they call it the air sac mite. But you can also see it in other parts of the respiratory tree as well. Like so many of these respiratory parasites, eggs usually are laid. They're coughed up, swallowed, passed out in the feces, and then taken up by other naive animals. So Cytodites nudus, the air sac mite. Now, if you deal with non-human primates, especially wild-caught non-human primates, they also have a mite which lives its entire life in the lung. This, if you take a look at these lungs, you will see these slightly raised, discrete, golden-brown areas. And these are known as mite houses of Pneumonisis simicola. Pneumonisis simicola is primarily a lung mite of old world monkeys like macaques. New world monkeys have a similar, less common parasite known as Pneumonisoides. So the life cycle of this parasite is direct. You will see all stages of the mite, the adults, the nymphs, and the eggs in these mite houses. And the eggs are probably ultimately coughed up, swallowed, passed into the environment to complete its life cycle. So what you get, if you're dealing with a wild-caught monkey, it's not common in laboratory-reared monkey because these can be easily treated with ivermectin. most wild-caught macaques will be dosed with ivermectin as part of the isolation process or the quarantine process. And what happens with these, they generally don't cause a whole lot of problems for the macaques. But here's a fixed section. And this is a section through at least one mite house and several more. And so the mites get into the small bronchioles. And through the process of moving around, laying down feces, which is known as mite pigment, and gives that sort of golden brown appearance that we saw here. That's all mite pigment. And that induces a granulomatous reaction. And so it sort of dissolves the elastin in the wall and hollows out this area. The whitish part around these mite houses is a combination of granulomatous inflammation, pigment, and fibrous connective tissue. So they form these hollowed out ectatic bronchioles, and the inflammation that you see is a combination of granulomatous inflammation and eosinophils, which you often see in association with various parasites that cause a tissue reaction. Your morphologic diagnosis for this should be something along the lines of granulomatous and eosinophilic bronchiolitis with bronchiectasis. Don't leave out that bronchiectasis. Usually there's a lot of fibrosis and smooth muscle hyperplasia in there as well. As we said before, it doesn't cause a whole lot of problem for infected macaques. Every once in a while, you can see these large bulla, which can rupture and result in a pneumothorax, but it's not really a common issue. So look closely, you'll see more of these mite houses here. Okay, pneumonisis simicola. Okay, let's finish this lecture and go back to that penniston. Remember the degenerate arthropod that sort of resembles a crustacean? If you deal with non-human primates, or occasionally you can see it in other carnivorous species like dogs, but it's much better known in non-human primates. There are a bunch of different types of penistomes, where the eggs are ingested by the monkeys. The nymph will get out of the intestine, and usually in non-human primates, it will insist in the pleura or the peritoneum or the omentum, usually on the surfaces of viscera, and it will develop into this curly appearing, very characteristic for penistomes. You usually don't see them in large numbers. There have been a number of cases in dogs where they're in huge numbers, but usually little onesies and twosies in affected macaques. And to get back to the reason I'm showing this is that these arthropods do have hooklets in their anterior end, and that's how they got their name. The first people who looked at this made a bit of an anatomical misanalysis, and they thought each of these were separate mouths. They're just hooklets for anchoring. There's no mouth parts associated with it. And so they counted five of them, and they said these are five mouths, and they came up with the term pentastome, stoma meaning mouth in Greek. But it's wrong. But they're just very interesting creatures. The other thing about the pentastomes is they look very different when they migrate from the intermediate host of the non-human primate to their final host. And the final host is usually a reptile, most often a snake, but you can also see them in turtles as well. There's a great case of penistomes in a turtle in the 2019-2021 slide conference 23, I think. And this is what they look like. They look like a long coiled worm, but they're not a worm. We've talked about this before. They're an arthropod, and they live in the lungs of reptiles. And it's funny, people can get pentastomes too. They can be an intermediate host. There are numbers of countries in Africa where on the street they will cook and serve snake as it's a form of bushmeat. And so the snakes are cooked intact, and then the person buys them from the vendor, sits down on the street, and starts eating all the parts of the snake. And these are known locally as snake springs. And so they're eating, you know, the inside of the snake and the viscera, and then they spit these out. They know to spit these out because if they chew them, then it's going to release the eggs, and they can end up with penistomes as well. So it's probably not a good idea to eat a poorly cooked snake in Africa. So stay away from that. And if you do have to eat poorly cooked snake, that's some sort of compulsion you have, make sure that you spit out the snake springs. Okay, well, that covers all of, there's probably a lot more, but I won't keep everybody up at night having nightmares about having arthropods in your respiratory system. So that will cover this pretty nicely. And we will see you again. Our next lecture is going to be on toxicologic diseases that affect the lung. It'll also be a short lecture. So I hope you come back from that. I wish you all great health, wonderful happiness, and I hope that you'll come back to the Foundation's Facebook page, our YouTube channel, or the JPC's video library to view more of these lectures. Thanks so much for your time, and I'll see you again.